This is Steve Race in the Beatles recording studio in London, where the latest Beatle record is at this moment being built up. Not just a single performance, but a whole montage of performances. With some friends in to help the atmosphere, this is quite an occasion.
When the Beatles performed All You Need Is Love on live TV in 1967, it was the first time most people had seen inside a recording studio. Steve Race had to explain the techniques being used to...
Thank you, John. Run back the tape, please, Richard.
There's several days' work on him. The engineer runs it back to the start for yet another stage in the making of an almost sir. The boys began by making a second track of vocal back, a third track. Now comes the final stage.
There's no mention of musicianship or songwriting. It's the science that's driving the music. Tomorrow's World stimulating Top of the Pops. I think this has always been the case, and in this programme, I'm meeting a range of musicians and critics who agree with me.
I think it's entirely right. You could go way back. You could go back to Chopin. You couldn't imagine his piano music without a sustain pedal.
Composer and arranger, Anne Dudley.
That's what happens. Musicians come across new technological advantages and exploit them.
Music journalist David Hepworth.
I think you're definitely right because, you know, musicians get excited by the kit that they've got and at any particular time. And if it suddenly has new capabilities, they will exploit those capabilities, often to far too much, you know, but there's just the natural joy of small boys on Christmas Day.
Musician and writer Thomas Dolby.
I think that technological innovation is hugely important to the way artists and musicians respond. And I think it's partly the creative tools and it's partly the distribution. I mean, you go back to roll pianos and jukeboxes and cable TV and all the rest of it, the internet, and it all has a profound effect on the way you think when you sit down to write and record a song.
We'll come back to keyboards in a minute, but let's start with the guitar. For centuries, it sounded like this. Then guitar players wanted their instruments to be louder, so someone came up with the idea of using steel strings instead of gut. Tom Atta, blues player and lecturer at the University of Salford, takes up the story.
Quite famously, there's a fellow called W.C. Handy, who's also regarded as the father of the blues. And he tells a story in his 1942 biography of being at a train station in Tutwiler. And he describes a ragged man with the sadness of the ages plunking on a guitar and playing the weirdest music I'd ever heard. And this moment is commonly held to be one of the moments where he discovers the blues and sets it down in written form, which allows it to propagate. Now, the interesting thing about this is that in order for the musician to be playing in the way that Handy describes, i.e. moving a knife up and down the strings to produce a sound, the strings themselves have to be made of metal. So it's not until around the mid-1890s, early 1900s, that there are guitars that can actually stand the pressure and the physics that are involved when you string a guitar with steel strings.
You better come on in my kitchen. There's hard to be raining.
It could be argued that the history of music amongst African Americans is the history of innovation, which is forced almost by a lack of new musical technology, but the adaptation of technology. So we think of
you brought it way down here.
The sound of Muddy Waters overloading a valve microphone. We think of the sound of Little Walter overloading his amplifier by blowing so hard into his harmonica. All of these things are adaptations and innovations that are used creatively.
From there, progress was rapid. In the 1930s, Charlie Christian put an electromagnetic pickup on his guitar so he could be heard over a jazz band. In the 1940s, Les Paul invented the solid body guitar, which he called the plank. And Les Paul was also one of the pioneers of multi-track recording. He took a tape recorder designed to help with dictation in the office and used it as a creative tool in his studio. And then, in the early 1960s, came Joe Meek and Telstar. See, when I first heard Telstar on the radio, I mean, it was otherworldly. That's how guitars sounded. I mean, guitars actually haven't changed that much technologically. But what we do with them was this very, very rapid progress. It went from that really clean sound that you had an amplifier and a bit of reverb in the studio, and that was it. Then you discovered distortion. So in order to do that, you needed to buy a huge amplifier, really overdrive it, wah-wah pedals, distortion pedals, and huge amounts of volume.
At the time, you suddenly had young engineers getting behind the board, and they were going, what happens if you press this button? Oh, that's weird. And anything weird was great. What do you want your record to be? I want it to be really weird. And so you get the small faces and all these people lathering it with phasing, you know. It was the internationally recognised signal that this record's been smoking something.
And you used to wait, you know, with bated breath and your 6 and 11 pins in your hot, sweaty hand, ready to go out and buy the next record because there was something on there that you would never have heard before. I remember hearing Queen with Keep Yourself Alive with this flanged guitar, and I wanted a flanger. You know, I wanted this thing. I wanted to be able to make that noise. And as David Hepworth remembers, all this power changed not only the way musicians made music, but the way audiences listened to it.
When Marshall launched, the first 100-watt amplifier in 1965, that enabled bands to, for the first time, drown out their audiences. You know, because I can remember going to see Chuck Berry and things like that, slightly before that, when, you know, the sound of an audience, if they talked too much, the band wouldn't be able to hear themselves think. Whereas suddenly you get this huge amplification, so you can fill any space.
That makes a huge amount of difference. I mean, my first concert when I was 5 years old was the Beatles' Christmas concert at Hammersmith Odeon. All I remember was the screaming, you know, their columns were about the size of my home stereo.
As a kind of averagely anoraki bloke in his late teens and early 20s, you would go to gigs and you would get in there long before the band came on and you would just look at the gear, wouldn't you? And it was a huge part of the excitement. Oh, look what they've got! You know, Canned Heat have got more than Blue Cheer had a couple of weeks earlier, you know, so there was always this technology arms race.
Good evening,
so without innovation and amplification, we wouldn't have had stadium rock, and you wouldn't be going to a festival next summer. And it wasn't just a boy thing. In the 1970s, a young Ann Dudley was increasingly distracted from her piano lessons.
I remember listening to certain records on the radio and thinking, I have no idea how they do that. One of the records was bizarrely by The Sweet, actually, Blockbuster. It was pretty innovative at the time. There's sounds on it that I didn't know as a sort of kid learning the piano where those sounds came from. So when I came across my first synthesizer, which was a Korg 700, it was extremely exciting, especially it had this little button that said bender. It made all the notes go wow, wow, wow. It's fantastic.
It's amazing to think that the synthesizer used to be a thing operated by men in white coats. You know, the idea that a normal civilian could play it is just ridiculous. And so, you know, Stevie Wonder made his three great records, Talking Book and Music of My Mind and all that, with Tonto's expanding headband, because they'd invented a synthesizer. And he wouldn't have even known how to do it.
Now, for a guitarist like me, where you're limited to amplifiers, speakers, a few effects pedals, this opened up an entire spectrum for me. You know, although back in the 80s you had a small fortune and a very large house to house all this stuff, I'm now sitting in front of a computer in my studio that's full of soft synthesizers. Now, these things are just software versions of the same beasts, the same huge things we used to have in the 80s. Now, I can sit with this tool and play a little melody like this. If I play it on a bit of a piano sound here, you're going to get this. Now, that one melody, that one little simple line, I can then add or replace the sounds with synthesized sounds. So here. an electronic string sound or an organ or... or a very electronic synth. Or a sequencer, here we go. So it starts to take shape. Now we can add some drums to that. This becomes my band. I can sit here and come up with an idea and start honing it and playing with it and turning it around, even to the extent that once I've finished this complete thing, writing it in sections, writing a, you know, verse and a chorus and a middle eight and things, once I've got all of these things, if I decide I don't want it in a major key, if I've written it, I can easily pop into what I've done and manipulate the electronics and drop it to a minor key or a major seventh or whatever I feel like doing. So it's constantly manipulative and pliable, which means that I suppose the hardest thing about this is knowing as a musician, as a creator, when to stop. 30 years ago, of course, all this was science fiction. But then, providing you the mountain of cash, along came the Fairlight.
To give you some perspective, the year that I bought it for £90,000, I bought a flat in central London for £26,000. So in today's money, that's a couple of million quid's worth of gear right there. And, you know, your smartphone there has probably got more sampling power than my Fairlight had. But it was amazingly liberating to have suddenly not only a library of all the orchestral instruments that really sounded like themselves for the first time, but also the ability to do creative stuff with sampling anything was just fantastic. Among the sounds in the Fairlight library, there was some Latin American percussion, and there were some samples of a thing called a güiro, which is a sort of long wooden carved piece with sort of slats on it that you scrape, you know, a piece of wood or metal over. And slowed down to about a quarter of its pitch, it sounds like a reptile. In fact, it sounds a bit like a sort of an armadillo or something that the güiro looks rather like. And I used that over the years in several recordings in a very reptilian way in songs like Pulp Culture and Silk Pajamas.
When I was doing the Band-Aid record, I recorded my vocals going, just a simple multi-tracked, then I sampled it, I changed the pitch of it, dropped it an octave, and then played it back on a keyboard, and it's the opening sound at the beginning of the Band-Aid record. It sounds a bit like a didgeridoo, but it's me.
It's Christmas time.